Then he realized the sounds were nearer and behind him. There were rats scuffling at the rear of the cavern. He lit the flashlight up again and jogged into the cave and found the 20 men. They were heaped into a large pile of corpses just before the roof got too low for a man to stand. 20 dead soldiers. A hell of a mess. They had all been shot in the back. Reacher could see that. They had been standing together in a group somewhere, and they had been mown down with heavy machine gun fire from the rear. He bent and grunted and turned a couple of them over. Not the toughest guys he'd ever seen. Docile reservist types, deployed to a lonely base deep inside friendly territory, ambushed and murdered for their weapons. But how? He knew how. An old ground-to-air unit, nearing obsolescence, stationed in the far north of Montana. A leftover from Cold War paranoia, certainly due for decommissioning. Probably already in the process of decommissioning. Probably on its way south to Peterson in Colorado. Final orders probably transmitted in clear by radio. He remembered the radio scanner back in the communications hut. The operator decided to patiently turn the dial. He imagined the recall order being accidentally intercepted. The operator running to Borken. Borken's bloated face lighting up with an opportunistic smile. Then some hasty planning. And a brutal ambush somewhere in the hills. 20 men shot down, thrown into their own truck, piled into this cavern. He stood and gazed at the appalling sight. Then he snapped the flashlight off again. Because he had been right about the noise. It was the noise of footsteps on the shale outside. He heard them again. They were getting closer. They were building to a deafening crunching sound in the night. They were heading straight for the shed. On the shale. No way of telling how many people there were. He heard them stop outside the massive doors, heard the jingle of keys, heard the padlocks rattle. The chains were pulled off and the log lifted aside. The doors sagged open. He dropped to the ground, lay face down, and pressed himself up against the pile of cold and oozing bodies. 4 feet, 2 voices. Voices he knew well, Fowler and Borken, talking quietly, walking confidently. Reacher let his body sag against the pile. A rat ran over his hand. Did he say when? Fowler was asking. His voice was suddenly loud against the rock.
First thing tomorrow morning,
Borken was saying.
Thon Company starts its linemen when? About 8 o'clock, maybe 7:30?
Let's be cautious, Fowler said. Let's call it 7:30. First thing they do is cut the line. They had flashlights. The beams flicked and swung as they walked.
No problem,
Borken said.
7 o'clock here is 9 o'clock on the East Coast. Perfect timing. We'll do it at 7. D.C. first, then New York, then Atlanta. Should be all done by 10 past. 10 minutes that shook the world, right? 20 minutes to spare.
They stopped at the second truck, unbolted the tailboard. It came down with a loud metallic clang. Then what? Fowler asked.
Then we wait and see,
Borken replied.
Right now, they've only got 8 Marines up here. They don't know what to do. They're not sure about the forest. White House is pussyfooting like we thought. Give them 12 hours for a decision. They can't try anything before dark tomorrow earliest. And by then, this place will be way down their list of priorities.
They were leaning into the truck.
Wooden.
Their voices were muffled by the thick canvas siding. Does he need the missile as well? Fowler asked.
Just the launcher,
Borken answered.
It's in the electronic part.
Reacher lay among the scuffling rats and heard the sound of the clips being undone. Then the squeak of the rubber as a launcher came out of its mountings. Then the rattle of the tailgate bolts ramming home. The footsteps receded. The flashlight beams flicked back toward the doors. The hinges creaked, and the bulky timber doors thumped shut. Reacher heard the launcher being laid gently on the shale, and the gasps as the 2 men lifted the old log back into the brackets. and waited. Walked slowly to the door. Listened hard. Waited 6 minutes. Put his hands into the gap at the bottom of the doors and pulled them apart. They wouldn't move more than an inch. He laid his palms flat on the smooth timbers and bunched up his shoulders and heaved. They were rock solid, like trying to push over a tree. He tried for a minute. He was straining like a weightlifter. The doors were jammed. Then he suddenly realized why. They had put the warped old log back in the brackets the other way around. The curve pointing in toward him, not out away from him. Clamping the doors with extra efficiency instead of allowing the foot of loose movement it had allowed before. He pictured the log as he had seen it. More than a foot thick, warped, but dried like iron. Curving away, it was no problem. Curving in, it would be immovable. He glanced at the army trucks. Gave it up. There was no space to hit the doors with any kind of momentum. The truck would be pressing on them with all the torque of a big diesel engine. But it wouldn't be enough. He couldn't imagine how much force it would take to shatter that old log. He thought about using a missile. Gave it up. Too noisy, and it wouldn't work anyway. They didn't arm themselves until they were 30 feet into the air. And they only carried 6.5 pounds of explosive. Enough to smash a jet engine in flight. But 6.5 pounds of explosive against those old timbers would be like scratching at them with a nail file. He was trapped inside, and Holly was waiting. It was not in his nature to panic. Never had been. He was a calm man, and his long training had made him calmer. He had been taught to assess and evaluate, and to use pure force of will to prevail. You're Jack Reacher, he had been told. You can do anything. First his mother had told him, then his father, then the quiet, deadly men in the training schools. And he had believed them. But at the same time, he hadn't believed them. Part of his mind always said, you've just been lucky. Always lucky. And in the quiet times, he would sit and wait for his luck to run out. He sat on the stony ground with his back against the timbers of the door and asked himself, has it run out now? He flicked a flashlight beam around the cavern. The rats were staying away from him. They were interested in the darkness and back. They're deserting me, he thought. Deserting the sinking ship. Then his mind clicked in again. No. They're interested in the tunnels, he thought. Because tunnels lead places. He remembered the giant mouse holes blasted into the rock face, north wall of the bowl. Maybe all interconnected by these narrow seams and back. He ran back into the depth of the cavern, past the trucks, past the grotesque heap of corpses, back to where he could no longer stand. A rat disappeared into the seam to his left. He dropped on his stomach and flicked a flashlight on, crawled after it. He crawled into a skeleton. He scrabbled with his feet and came face to face with a grinning skull. And another. There were 4 or 5 skeletons jammed into the excavated seam. Jumbled bones in a pile.
What happened again?
He gasped in shock and backed off a foot. Looked carefully. Used the flashlight close up.
You hadn't realized.
All males. He could see that from the 5 pelvises. The skulls showed gunshot wounds. All in the temples. Neat entry wounds. Neat exit holes. Jacketed high-velocity handgun bullets. Fairly recent. Certainly within a year. The flesh hadn't decayed. It had been eaten off. He could see the parallel scrape marks on the bones from rodent teeth. The bones were all disturbed. The rats had hauled them away to eat. There were scraps of clothing material here and there. Some of the rib cages were still covered. Rats don't disturb clothing much. Not on the torso. Why should they? They eat their way in through the inside. The soft parts first. They come to the ribs from the back. The clothing material was khaki and olive green. Some black and gray camouflage. Northwestern Freeman. He pulled at the skeleton's jacket. The rib cage collapsed. The breast pocket had three chromium stars punched through. Reacher made a thorough search, lying on his stomach, up to his armpits and bones. He pieced together five separate uniforms. He found two more badges. One said, White Christian Identity. The other said, Montana Constitutional Militia. He lined up the five splintered skulls, checked the teeth. He was looking at five men, middle-aged, maybe between 40 and 50. Five leaders. The leaders who had disappeared. The leaders who could not stand the pace. The leaders who had abandoned their members to Bo Borkum. The roof was too low for Reacher to climb over the bones. He had to push them aside and crawl through them. The rats showed no interest. These bones were picked clean. Their new feast lay back inside the cavern. They swarmed back in that direction. He held the flashlight out in front of him and pushed on into the mountain against the squealing tide. He lost his sense of direction. He hoped he was going roughly west, but he couldn't tell. The roof came down to a couple of feet. He was crawling through an old geological seam, excavated long ago for its ore. The roof came down even more, down to a foot and a half. It was cold. The seam narrowed. His arms were out in front of him. The seam became too narrow to pull them back. He was crawling down a slim rock tube, a billion tons of mountain above him. No idea where he was going. And the flashlight was failing. The battery was spent. Its light was fading to a dull orange glow. He was breathing hard and shaking. Not from exertion, from dread, from terror. This was not what he had expected. He had visualized a stroll down a spacious abandoned gallery, not this narrow crack in the rock. He was pushing himself head first into his worst childhood nightmare. He was a guy who had survived most things, and he was a guy who was rarely afraid. But he had known since his early boyhood that he was terrified of being trapped in the dark in a space too small to turn his giant frame. All his damn childhood nightmares had been about being closed into tight spaces. He lay on his stomach and screwed his eyes shut, lay and panted and gagged. Forced the air in and out through his clamping throat. Then he inched himself slowly onward into the nightmare. The glow from the flashlight finally died 100 yards into the tunnel. The darkness was total. The seam was narrowing. It was pushing his shoulders down. He was forcing himself into a space that was way too small for him. His face was forced sideways. He fought to stay calm. He remembered what he had said to Borkum. People were smaller then. Scrappy little guys, migrating west, seeking their fortune in the bowels of the mountain. People half the size of Reacher, squirming along, maybe on their backs, chipping the bright veins out of the rock roof. He was using the dead flashlight like a blind man uses a white cane. It smashed on solid rock 2 feet ahead of his face. He heard the tinkle of glass over the rasping of his breath. He struggled ahead and felt with his hands. A solid wall. The tunnel went no farther. He tried to move backward. He couldn't move at all. To push himself backward with his hands, he had to raise his chest to get leverage. But the roof was too low to let him do that. His shoulders were jammed up hard against it. He could get no leverage. His feet could push him forward, but they couldn't pull him backward. He went rigid with panic. His throat clamped solid. His head hit the roof, and his cheek hit the grit floor. He fought a scream by breathing fast. He had to go back. He hooked his toes into the grit, turned his hands inward, and planted his thumbs on the floor. Pulled with his toes, and pushed with his thumbs. He moved backward a fraction, and then the rock clamped hard against his sides. slide his weight backward, his shoulder muscles were bunching and jamming against the rock. He breathed out and let his arms go limp. Pulled with his toes. They scrabbled uselessly in the grit. He helped them with his thumbs. His shoulders bunched and jammed again. He jerked his hips from side to side. He had a couple of inches spare. He smashed his hands into the shale and heaved backward. His body jammed solid, like a wedge in a door. He tilted sideways and banged his cheek on the roof. Jerked back down and caught his other cheek on the floor. The rock was crushing in on his ribs. This time he couldn't fight the scream. He had to let it go. He opened his mouth and wailed in terror. The air in his lungs crushed his chest against the floor and his back against the roof. He couldn't tell if his eyes were open or shut. He pushed forward with his feet and regained the inch he'd moved back. He stretched with his arms, felt up ahead again. His shoulders were jammed so tight he couldn't move his hands through much of an angle. He spread his fingers and scrabbled them left and right, up and down. Solid rock ahead. No way to go forward, no way to move backward. He was gonna die trapped inside the mountain. He knew it. The rats knew it. They were sniffing up behind him, coming closer. He felt them at his feet. He kicked out and sent them squealing away. But they came back. He felt their weight on his legs. They were swarming over him. They burrowed up around his shoulders, slid under his armpits. He felt cold, oily fur on his face as they forced their way past. The flick of their tails as they ran ahead. To where? He let them run over his arm to estimate their direction. They were moving ahead of him into the blind darkness. He felt with his hands, felt them flowing left. Their passage was stirring the air. The air was cool. He felt it move, a faint breeze on the sweat on the left side of his face. He jammed himself hard against the right-hand wall and moved his left arm sideways ahead of him. Felt for the left-hand wall. It wasn't there. He was stuck at a junction in the tunnels. A new seam ran at a right angle away from the end of the seam he was in. A tight, narrow right angle. 90 degrees. He forced himself backward as far as his thumbs would push him. He scraped his face on the end wall and jammed his side into the rock. Folded himself arms first around the corner and dragged his legs behind him. The new seam was no better. It was no wider. The roof was no higher. He hauled himself along, gasping and sweating and shaking. He propelled himself with his toes, an inch at a time. The rats forced their way past him. The rock tore at his sides and his back. But there was still a slight breeze on his face. The tunnel was heading somewhere. He was gasping and panting. He crawled on. Then the new seam widened. Still very low. A flat, low crack in the rock. He crawled on through it. Exhausted. 50 yards. 100. Then he felt the roof soar away above him. He pushed on with his toes, and suddenly he felt the air change, and he was lying halfway into the motor pool cavern. He realized his eyes were wide open, and the white Decano line was right there in front of him in the dark. He rolled onto his back and lay gasping on the grit, gasping and shaking. Staggered to his feet and looked back. The scene was invisible, hidden in the shadow. He made it as far as the white truck and collapsed against its side. The luminous figures on his watch showed he'd been in the tunnels nearly 3 hours. Most of the time jammed there, sweating in panic. A 3 hour screaming nightmare come to life. His pants and his jacket were shredded. Every muscle in his body was on fire. His face and hands and elbows and knees were bleeding. But it was the fear that had done it to him. The fear of not getting through. He could still feel the rock pressing down on his back and pressing up on his chest. He could ribs. He got up again and limped to the doors, pushed them open and stood in the moonlight, arms out, eyes crazy, mouth open, breathing in lungfuls of the sweet night air. He was halfway across the bowl before he started thinking straight. So he ran back and ducked into the motor pool once more, found what he wanted. He found it on one of the Jeep's tow hook assemblies. Some heavy stiff wire, ready to feed a trailer's electric circuits. He wrenched it out and stripped the insulation with his teeth. Ran back to the moonlight. He kept close to the road, all the way back to York. 2 miles, 20 minutes at a slow, agonizing jog through the trees. He looked around behind the ruined northeastern block and approached the courthouse from the rear, circled it silently in the shadows, waited and listened. He tried to think like Borkum, complacent, happy with his perimeter, constant information. The FBI. Reacher, locked into the punishment hut. Holly, locked into her prison room. Would he post a sentry? Not tonight. Not when he was expecting heavy action tomorrow and beyond. He would want his people fresh. Reacher nodded, and Gambley was right. He climbed to the courthouse steps. Deserted. He tried the door. Locked. He smiled. Nobody posts a sentry behind a locked door. He bent the wire into a shallow hook and felt for the mechanism. An old two-lever. 8 seconds. He stepped inside, waited and listened. Nothing. He went up the stairs. The lock on Holly's door was new, but cheap. He worked quietly, which delayed him. It took more than 30 seconds before the last tumbler clicked back. He pulled the door open slowly and stepped onto the built-up floor. Glanced apprehensively at the walls. She was on a mattress on the floor, fully dressed and ready, awake and watching him. Huge eyes bright in the gloom. He gestured her outside, turned and climbed down and waited in the corridor for her. She picked up her crutch and limped to the door, climbed carefully down the step and stood next to him.
Hello, Reacher, she whispered. How are you doing?
I felt better, he whispered back. Time to time. She turned and glanced back into her room. He followed her gaze and saw the dark stain on the floor.
Woman who brought me lunch, she whispered.
He nodded. What with? He whispered back.
Part of the bed frame,
she said. He saw the satisfaction on her face and smiled.
That should do it,
he said quietly. Bed frames are good for that. She took a last look at the room and gently closed the door, followed him through the dark and slowly down the stairs, across the lobby and through the double doors, and out into the bright, silent moonlight.
Christ,
she said urgently.
What happened to you?
He glanced down and checked himself over in the light of the moon. He was gray from head to foot with dust and grit. His clothing was shredded. He was streaked with sweat and blood. Still shaky.
Long story, he said.
You got somebody in Chicago you can trust?
McGraw,
she said immediately.
He's my agent in charge. Why?
They crossed the wide street arm in arm, looking left and right. Skirted the mound in front of the ruined office building. Found the path running northwest.
You need to send him a fax, he said. They've got missiles. You need to warn him. Tonight. Because their line is going to be cut first thing in the morning. The mole told them that?
She asked. He nodded.
How? She asked. How was he communicating?
Shortwave radio, Reacher said. Has to be. Anything else is traceable. He swayed and leaned on a tree. Gave her the spread. Everything. Beginning to end.
Shit, she said. Ground-to-air missiles. Mass suicide? A nightmare.
Not our nightmare, he said. We're out of here.
We should stay and help them,
she said.
The families.
He shook his head. Best help is for us to get out, he said. Maybe losing you will change their plan. And we can tell them about the layout around here.
I don't know,
she said. I do, he said. First rule is stick to priorities. That's you. We're out of here. She shrugged and nodded.
Now?
She asked. Right now, he said.
How?
She asked. Jeep through the forest, he said. I found their motor pool. We get up there and steal the Jeep. By then it should be light enough to find our way through. I saw a map in Borkin's office. There are plenty of tracks running east through the forest. She nodded, and he pushed off the tree. They hustled up the winding path to the bastion, a mile in the dark. They stumbled on the stones and saved their breath for walking. The clearing was dark and silent. They worked their way around beyond the mess hall to the back of the communications hut. They came out of the trees, and Reacher stepped close and pressed his ear to the plywood siding. There was no sound inside. He used the wire again, and they were inside within 10 seconds. Holly found paper and pen, wrote her message, dialed the Chicago fax number, and fed the sheet into the machine. It whirred obediently and pulled the paper through, fed it back out into her waiting hand. She hit the button for the confirmation. Didn't want to leave any trace behind. Another sheet fed out. It showed the destination number correct. Timed the message at 5:10, Friday morning, the 4th of July. She shredded both papers small and buried the pieces in the bottom of a trash can. Reacher rooted around on the long counter and found a paperclip. Followed Holly back out into the moonlight and relocked the door. Dodged around and found the cable leading down from the shortwave whip into the side of the hut. Took the paperclip and worried at it until it broke. Forced the broken end through the cable like a pin. Pushed it through until it was even, a fraction showing at each side. The metal would short-circuit the antenna by connecting the wire inside to the foil screen. The signal would come down out of the ether, down the wire, leak into the foil, and run away to ground without ever reaching the shortwave unit itself. Best way to disable a radio. Smash one up, it gets repaired. This way, the fault is untraceable, until an exhausted technician finally thinks to check.
We need weapons,
Holly whispered to him. He nodded. They crept together to the armory door. He looked at the lock, gave it up. It was a huge thing, unpickable. I'll take the Glock from the guy guarding me, he whispered. She nodded. They ducked back into the trees and walked through to the next clearing. Reacher tried to think of a story to explain his appearance to Joseph Ray. Figured he might say something about being beamed over to the UN. Talk about how high-speed beaming can rip you up a little. They crept around behind the punishment hut and listened. All quiet. They skirted the corner and Reacher pulled the door. Walked straight into a 9mm. This time, it wasn't a Glock. It was a Sig Sauer. Not Joseph Ray's. It was Bo Borkin's. He was standing just inside the door, with little Stevie at his side, grinning. Chapter 37. 4:30 in the morning, Webster was more than ready for the watch change. Johnson and Garber and the General's aide were dozing in their chairs. McGraw was outside with the telephone linemen. They were just finishing up. The job had taken much longer than they had anticipated. Some kind of interface problem. They had physically cut the phone line coming out of York and bent the stiff copper down to a temporary terminal box they had placed at the base of a pole. Then they had spooled cable from the terminal box down the road to the mobile command vehicle, connected it into one of the communications ports. But it didn't work. Not right away. The linemen had fussed with multimeters and muttered about impedances and capacitances. They had worked for 3 solid hours. They were ready to blame the army truck for the incompatibility. When they thought to go back and check their own temporary terminal box, the fault lay there. A failed component. They wired in a spare, and the whole circuit worked perfectly. 4:35 in the morning. McGraw was shaking their hands and swearing them to silence when Webster came out of the trailer. The two men stood and watched them drive away. The noise of their truck died around the curve. Webster and McGraw stayed standing in the bright moonlight. They stood there for 5 minutes while McGraw smoked. They didn't speak, just gazed north into the distance and wondered. "Go wake your boys up," Webster said. "We'll stand down for a spell." McGraw nodded and walked down to the accommodation trailers, roused Milosevic and Brogan. They were fully dressed on their bunks. They got up and yawned, came down the ladder, and found Webster standing there with Johnson and his aide, Garber standing behind them. "The telephone line is done," Webster said. "Already?" Brogan said. "I thought it was being done in the morning." "We figured sooner was better than later," Webster said. He inclined his head toward General Johnson. It was a gesture which said, "He's worried, right?" "Okay," Milosevic said. "We'll look after it." "Wake us at 8, Webster said. "Or earlier if necessary, okay?" Brogan nodded and walked north to the command vehicle. Milosevic followed. They paused together for a look at the mountains in the moonlight. As they paused, the fax machine inside the empty command trailer started whirring. It fed its first communication face upward into the message tray. It was 10 to 5 in the morning, Friday the 4th of July. Brogan woke General Johnson an hour and 10 minutes later, 6 o'clock exactly. He knocked loudly on the accommodation trailer door and got no response, so he went in and shook the old guy by the shoulder. "Here's an Air Force base, sir," Brogan said. "They need to talk to you." Johnson staggered up to the command vehicle in his shirt and pants. Milosevic joined Brogan outside in the pre-dawn glow to give him some privacy. Johnson was back out in 5 minutes.
"I'm gonna catch you straight away."
He ducked back into the trailer. Milosevic walked down and roused the others. They came forward, Webster and the general's aide yawning and stretching, Garber ramrod straight. McGraw was dressed and smoking. Maybe hadn't tried to sleep at all. They filed up the ladder and took their places around the table. Bleak red eyes, hair buzzed on the back from the pillows. "Peterson called," Johnson told them. "They're sending a helicopter search and rescue out. First light, looking for the missile unit." His aide nodded. "That would be standard procedure," he said. "Based on an assumption," Johnson said. "They think the unit has suffered some kind of mechanical and electrical malfunction." "Which is not uncommon," his aide said. "If their radio fails, their procedure would be to repair it. If a truck also broke down at the same time, their procedure would be to wait as a group for assistance." "Circle the wagons?" McGraw asked. The aide nodded again. "Exactly so," he said. "They would pull off the road and wait for a chopper." "So do we tell them?" McGraw asked. The aide sat forward. "That's the question," he said. "Tell them what, exactly? We don't even know for sure that these maniacs have got them at all. It's still possible it's just a radio problem and a truck problem together." "Dream on," Johnson said. Webster shrugged. He knew how to deal with such issues. "What's the upside?" he said. "There is no upside," Johnson said. "We tell Peterson the missiles have been captured, the cat's out of the bag. We lose control of the situation, we're seen to have disobeyed Washington by making an issue out of it before Monday." "Okay, so what's the downside?" Webster asked. "Theoretical," Johnson said. "We have to assume they've been captured. So we also have to assume they've been well hidden. In which case the Air Force will never find them. They'll just fly around for a while and then go home and wait." Webster nodded. "Okay," he said. "No upside, no downside, no problem." There was a short silence. "So we sit tight," Johnson said. "We missile reads it as friendly, refuses to launch. Guaranteed? McGraw asked. The aide nodded. Foolproof, he said. Garber glowered at him, but he said nothing. Not his field of expertise. Okay, Webster said. Back to bed. Wake us again at 8, Brogan. On the tarmac at Peterson, a Boeing CH-47D Chinook was warming its engines and sipping the first of its 858 gallons of fuel. A Chinook is a giant aircraft whose twin rotors thump through an oval of air 100 feet long and 60 wide. It weighs more than 10 tons empty, and it can lift another 11. It's a giant flying box, the engines and the fuel tank strapped to the top and the sides, the crew perched high at the front. Any helicopter can search, but when heavy equipment is at stake, only a Chinook can rescue. Because of the holiday weekend, the Peterson dispatcher assigned a skeleton crew of two. No separate spotter. He figured he didn't need one. How difficult could it be to find five army trucks on some shoulder in Montana?
You should have stayed here,
Borkin said. Right, Joe? Reacher glanced into the gloom inside the punishment hut. Joseph Ray was standing to attention on the yellow square. He was staring straight ahead. He was naked, bleeding from the mouth and nose.
Right, Joe?
Borkin said again. Ray made no reply. Borkin walked over and crashed his fist into his face. Ray stumbled and fell backward, staggered against the back wall, and scrambled to regain his position on the square.
I asked you a question,
Borkin said. Ray nodded. The blood poured off his chin.
Reacher should have stayed here, he said.
Borkin hit him again, a hard straight right to the face. Ray's head snapped back. Blood spurted. Borkin smiled.
No talking when you're on the square, Joe, he said. You know the rules.
Borkin stepped back and placed the muzzle of the Sig Sauer in Reacher's ear. Used it to propel him out into the clearing. Gestured Stevie to follow.
You stay on the square, Joe,
he called over his shoulder. Stevie slammed the door shut. Borkin reversed his direction and used the Sig Sauer to shove Reacher toward him.
Tell Fowler to get rid of this guy, he told him. He's outlived his usefulness, such as it ever was. Put the bitch back in her room. Put a ring of sentries right round the building. We got things to do, right? No time for this shit. Parade ground at 6:30. Everybody there. I'm going to read them the proclamation before we fax.
McGraw couldn't sleep. He walked back to the accommodations trailer with the others and got back on his bunk, but he gave it up after 10 minutes. 6:45 in the morning, he was back in the command vehicle with Brogan and Milosevic. You guys take a break if you want, he said. I'll look after things here. We could go organize some breakfast, Brogan said. Diners in Kalispell should be open by now. McGraw nodded vaguely, started into his jacket for his wallet. Don't worry about it, Brogan said. I'll